Welcome to the Nitro Proposers Day. It's a momentous occasion. It's the agency's first Proposers Day. So obviously big news for the program, big news for the agency as well. At this point, we all hope, and I hope that you've read the BAA. And I hope that you also know what Nitro is, what it means, what we're looking to do, and what we're aiming to accomplish. And if so, then hope you're excited as I am, and excited as we all are. This is an opportunity for the leading minds in regenerative medicine to peer through the looking glass at a future that seems impossible and or unimaginable to most people. With Nitro, we all have the opportunity in this room, online, and everyone else who might be submitting to the program, the opportunity to work together and change the course of history for the millions of Americans suffering from OA and the millions more who have yet been diagnosed. I'm excited to write history together and leave a positive, lasting legacy on healthcare with you. Before we get started, there's an order of events, so I want to make sure that everyone's briefed on what we should expect. This morning, we're going to have comments about the program, about ARPA, from everyone seated at these tables. Once we do that, we'll take a water break, and then we'll dive right into lightning talks. Now, you notice that there are going to be a blitz of lightning talks for the entire day. We're going to have simultaneous sidebar conversations if you scheduled those and if you submitted a lightning talk. So please don't be alarmed if we're running in and out. That's just kind of the flow of the day. With that busy schedule, there are a couple things that just are order of operations before we get running to keep things smoothly. First one, there will be no live Q&A. So if you want to ask a question and you want us to answer it, there are a couple ways we're going to do that. First, my technical CETAs, who, if you're part of the program, you'll see them quite a bit, Dr. Ryan Locke and Dr. Carrie Lehan, will be passing out note cards. If you have a question, write it down. We'll be collecting them at the end of the day, populating everything online with our answers. If you're online, we have an online Q&A format for you to be able to do the same exact thing. Additionally, they'll be writing down a lot of the questions in sidebars and lightning talks and adding that as well. So please don't be alarmed if you can't raise your hand and ask. We promise you'll be addressed just in a different forum because this is a busy, busy day. If you're online or in person, please don't record. We're going to be recording it and posting it online for reference for people who can't make it today. So just sit back and enjoy. And finally, the big thing with this program is if you've seen the BAA, you've noticed that these are very aggressive metrics, and that's the goal of the program. To hit these metrics, we anticipate teaming. And teaming means that a lot of you should feel free and encouraged to communicate with one another and the population online, especially if you said, I want my information shared, so that you can team with them after the fact. Without further ado, I will turn it over to the Mission Office Director, Dr. Amy Jenkins.
Okay, let's see. Can you all hear me? Yep, okay. Welcome, everybody. Really, really excited to see everybody here for our first ARPA-H Proposers Day. For those of you in person, it's great to see you all. For everybody online, welcome as well. Really looking forward to this day. This is probably the most important meetings we hold at ARPA-H. It may not feel that way, but these are really, I came from DARPA, and everybody else asked us at DARPA, how do you do all these things? How do you invent the internet and all this like GPS and all this crazy stuff? And the reason is because we put people in a room together that typically wouldn't talk to each other. And that is key to being able to meet the metrics of this effort. So please talk to each other. We are here simply here to facilitate. We'll review proposals, but the key here today is that you all talk to each other. So I'm going to give a little bit of an overview of ARPA-H from an agency level and from the Health Science Futures Office within that NITRO is within. So as many of you likely know, President Biden stood up the agency back in March of 2022. The idea here was to model an agency after DARPA's business practices, but for the agency to be focused on health and improving health outcomes. So with that, we have a very simple mission statement. We are here to accelerate better health outcomes for everyone. This slide is probably the slide that people get so most excited about because there are a lot of questions about where ARPA-H is in this biomedical ecosystem and in this funder ecosystem. And a lot of questions about where we sit within the NIH and HHS. It's a little weird, I'm gonna try to explain it here. And I'm also gonna give you some an understanding of the agency as a whole for those of you who are not familiar with DARPA and are not familiar with an ARPA. So we are an independent component of HHS within the NIH. So our director, Dr. Renee Wegerson, reports directly to the Secretary of Health and Human Services, Secretary Becerra. She does not report to Dr. Tabak. We are not an agency within, or we are not an IC, so we are not the 28th IC within the NIH. We are an agency that is administratively affiliated with the NIH. We have no internal research labs. We do not perform research. We don't have intramural work like they would have at the NIH. And we are disease agnostic. So I know there's been a lot of focus on cancer, diabetes, Alzheimer's. We will absolutely have efforts in that, in those areas. But as you can see, our first program is in osteoarthritis, and certainly not something that was highlighted at the beginning. And the reason for that is that our agency is programmed centric, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. We are an actual funding agency, and so it's important that a funding agency have an appropriation. We have currently have $2.5 billion of our initial appropriations. We are a separate line item from the NIH budget, so I want to make that very clear as well. We generally will fund contracts and not grants. So we won't fund just contracts. We'll also do things like cooperative agreements, which are assistance agreements. You're going to hear a lot more about that today. We will fund OTAs, but we typically will not fund grants. So this is an organization, and some people are uncomfortable with it. Trust me, you'll get comfortable with it. It's not that bad. But we do not issue grants for 5 years and ask people to come to a review once a year and tell us how the work is going. We issue cooperative agreements that have milestones and deliverables, and the program manager will talk to you many times a year, usually monthly, to see what the progress is that you're making. That's really important for us because there are organizations out there where their goal is to lay the fundamental basic science, the NIH, the NSF. Those are very important roles. They're frankly very important roles for us to have as well so that we can build off what they're doing. Here, we're capability building. So we want to build an end capability. It's very clear in Ross's BAA what he wants. He wants to build that end capability. He will monitor this program over the next 5 years to make sure that we're driving towards that end capability. We understand it's R&D, it's science. It's not always going to work the way you proposed in 2023 by 2028. So what may happen in 2024 or 2025, things are not working. You may say, you know, I want to take a different route. Okay, that's something we can do. We have flexible contracting. We can change the statement of work. We will work towards another path to get to the end goal. But what we won't do is say, oh, this is a cool result. Let's go down that path. We won't do that. We're solely focused on getting to that end goal. We have four offices, mission offices within ARPA-H. The first one that I'm going to talk about today primarily is a Health Science Futures office. This is the office that I am the director of within this office. At steady state, we anticipate having anywhere between 20 and 25 program managers. So not exact clones of Ross, but 20 to 25 program managers within this office. And I'll be the office director for that. What we're doing in the Health Science Futures office, and so a lot of people were very much anticipating ARPA-H to come out and say, here's our cancer office and here's our infectious disease offices, and here's our neuro office. We're not doing that. Our offices are actually organized by the types of technologies that we may fund in those offices, with solutions for many different disease states coming out of every office. In the Health Science Futures office, here we are expanding what's technically possible. We are inventing the future in this office. The idea here, for those of you, again, who are familiar with ARPAs, this is ARPA-H's ARPA office. So we are trying to really push the science, the new tools, technologies, and platforms, the scientific advances that are going to underlay all the great advances we'll be able to make throughout our time as an agency. I don't want to ignore the other offices, so I'll very quickly touch on them. Scalable solutions, here we're trying to ensure that we have technologies that are reaching everybody, both the cost and the scale that we need there. Proactive health, exactly what it sounds like. This is our office where we're trying to prevent people from becoming patients, both from an acute disease, but chronic diseases, think diabetes prevention, behavioral health. And then finally, the resilient systems office, for which we do have an office director, and there, that office is looking to build integrated health systems that are very resilient towards any impending types of threats. But let's focus on Health Science Futures because that's the office in which NITRO sits and the office we're largely talking about today. So as I mentioned, expanding what's technically possible, inventing the future, tools, technologies, and platforms will be in this office. We will tend to be somewhat disease agnostic, but that will not always be the case. Of course, in our first program, it's not the case. We give some examples down here, and the only reason we give these examples is to make it a bit more tangible for folks as they think about the types of things we may do in this office. So I like to talk about it on a scale. So we will invent and look at new tools at a molecular level, at a cellular level, and then even at the tissue and human and whole body level. So think new surgical tools, new techniques that will help us with maybe cell biology or immune cell manufacturing, and then all the way down to molecular tools. We'll talk a little bit about the ARPA-H ecosystem. All of you sitting here in this room are part of this ecosystem, and I'm going to start over here on the right-hand side of the slide. So we have stakeholders. We work with the NIH very closely with our NIH IC partners. We work with other federal partners like FDA, CMS. We work with private investors. We do work within the academic and industry. That'll be the bulk of our interactions on the performer side. So we do call the people that we fund performers. We're not looking for dances, but we are asking, we don't call them grantees because we don't issue grants. So we call them performers. We work with NGOs. And then most importantly, up on the top left, we work with customers. ARPA-H has the largest customer base of any ARPA. So if you think about DARPA, they're very much focused on the DOD, and ARPA-E very much focused on energy. We are touching everybody in the country. And so it's really important for us to make sure that we're reaching those customers, whether this be through healthcare providers or patient advocacy groups. And so I want to just briefly touch on the program managers, because this is really important that people understand this. And I think this is a very different model than most funding agencies. Our program managers come into ARPA-H for a 3-year term. So they are here for 3 years. They have the possibility of re-upping for another 3-year term, so a maximum of 6 years, and then they have to leave. Same goes for me as the office director. Same goes for our agency directors and deputy directors. This is an ever-changing agency. What this agency looks like today, it will not look like in 3 years, and it'll be entirely different in 6 years. The reason for that is that we are a high-risk, high-reward agency. We're looking to fund the new innovative ideas. And if you have the same people sitting in a building for 25 years, those ideas will inevitably get stale. You need new people. You need new ideas. You need new people coming in and looking at the programs and saying, nope, I would do this a different way. That's important. It can be frustrating, I understand, on the performer side, but it's really important in how we drive the innovation ecosystem. Program managers come in with that 3 to 6 year timeline. So I think somebody's done the math. I haven't done the math, but it's something like every week is 1%. Every 2 weeks is 1% of a program manager's time here. But Ross knows it intensely. And so that's the reason why everything is just push, 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 push. We want to go as quickly as possible. You'll hear from our contracts team today. We will likely have a contracting timeline that will be quite remarkable to many folks in the room if you're used to working with some other agencies. We got to move quickly because we just don't have the time to not move quickly. The program managers come in with their idea. I do not tell Ross what to do. The agency director does not tell me what to fund in my office. We are a bottoms-up agency, so we do not set priorities at the leadership level. We let the program managers come in with both a mix of ideas and the personality to do this job. They come in here with those ideas. It's their program. I help them mold that program. They have to convince me, and they have to convince the agency director that it's the right thing to do, that it's scientifically valid. They vet it, but we are not a top-down agency. So we are not telling groups to, or people to come in and do this thing. So many people will come to us and say, I've got this great idea for this thing in cancer. And I say, okay, who's the program manager? You want to be the program manager? And they're like, no, I just want it funded. I said, okay, well, I need the program manager first, because I'm not just going to tell somebody to do that. I need the program managers to do that. A different model, but it means that the people are very, very motivated to make the things that we're doing a reality. I think this is one of my last slides, but I do want to talk a little bit about program formation and how did we get here for NITRO. So as I've mentioned, program managers come in, they have an idea that they want to solve, a problem that they want to challenge in this community. They come to ARPA-H after a very thorough interview process, and they spend some time, a couple months, really figuring out what they want to do in this space, talking to experts, talking to other government agencies, ensuring that we're not being duplicative, ensuring that we're really pushing the bar and going very far. And there's certainly metrics in that BAA that are making many of you uncomfortable in this room and probably making Ross sitting here very uncomfortable. And that's the point. We don't change the world if we don't try to push our comfort level. So spend a couple months trying to figure out what the challenge is, and then they launch the program. So that's where we are today. When that BAA came out on May 17th, that was the launch of the NITRO program, our first program at ARPA-H. It was actually a very exciting day, and we will have many of those to come. At steady state, we will likely have 2 or 3 of those a month. That pace will start to pick up towards the end of the summer here. So you can anticipate BAAs, program-specific BAAs coming out of ARPA-H at a rate of about 2 to 3 per month. I think we're probably going to hit that sometime later this year. Program managers launch their program. They hold these great proposers days. You all propose. The proposals are reviewed by a team of government experts. We do not do study sections. That is another thing that is very different in the ARPA-H model. Ross will be one of your reviewers. He will pick 2 other reviewers, government reviewers that are under government NDA. They will read those proposals and they will provide their comments. We do not compare proposals. This is a broad agency announcement, so proposals are not compared directly against each other. They are not ranked. We are evaluating proposals based solely off those criteria that are listed in the BAA, number one of which is technical merit. After that team of reviewers provides those reviews, they talk to Ross, he holds a meeting, everybody talks. It's not a study section, it's just a quick meeting. They can say, two of the government reviewers can say, I would not fund this, it's too crazy, it's too risky. Ross can still fund it. He makes the final decision. He has to convince me as the scientific review official that he's doing the right thing. So we are good stewards of taxpayer dollars. We are not just throwing money at things that are not appropriate. But once he has convinced me that it's the right thing to do, he can make the final decision. Then you have performer teams, as I mentioned, are contractors that are performing against the metrics of this program for the duration of the program. And the final thing I'll note, and it does make some people uncomfortable, but it's the fact, is that because we do not issue grants and we have deliverables, some groups will make it all the way through. Some groups may not make it all the way through. It may not be working. We will not cut off funding with no notice. Particularly in academic labs, we recognize, you know, you have postdocs, you have graduate students on these awards. We do, there is a glide path, if you will, of ensuring that grad students and postdocs are covered. But if the effort isn't working and we've reworked it and we've redone the statement of work and we tried again a different way and it's still not working, the effort can be ended at Ross's discretion. And if the groups are not performing, we can end the effort as well. Some of those groups will graduate and transition and meet the goals of the NITRO program, and you're going to hear a little bit more from some of the other folks here at the agency about how we ensure that happens. What if you're wildly successful? How do you ensure that you either get follow-on funding or it just doesn't die? Because ARPA-H will not fund these in perpetuity, because Ross will leave and somebody else will come in and be like, I'm not going to do osteoarthritis. That program's already been done. I've got new ideas. So with that, I'm going to leave this here for all of you. I think many of you have likely seen this. The one thing I do want to point out here is that the BAA will close on July 28th. That's when full proposals are due at midnight, just before midnight. So please keep that in mind. You'll hear a little bit more about the details around the BAA, a lot more. I want to make two final comments. The first is there will be a lot of lightning talks today, 2 or 3 minute lightning talks. We have not vetted those lightning talks. Those lightning talks are not for us. They are for you. So we did not choose them. We do not endorse anybody in this room. We want you to talk to each other. So that is just simply a way for you to meet each other and know what capabilities are out there, not vetted by ARPA-H. The final note I'll make is that you see in our broad agency announcement in phase one, two, B, correct? Yeah, I'm going to remember it. Phase 2B of the program is looking for an IND filing with the FDA or an IDE filing, how it may be. 2.1A. Okay. There is metrics in the BAA that requires filing with the FDA. ARPA-H is not interested in any technology that cannot pass FDA regulatory muster. The exception to that would be EMA muster, but we are looking for regulated technologies. We anticipate that these will be fully regulated through the FDA and fully approved through the FDA or the EMA at some point in the course of the program. So making that abundantly clear, the BAA is the most important document you will read in this program. I recognize that many of the things out there, you're going to say, well, these are really hard technologies. They might not get FDA approval. We understand that, but they will be reviewed by the FDA. The BAA is really important. So I'm going to say it one more time. Everybody up here is probably going to say it. Read the BAA. Read every word of that BAA. If it says must, you must do it. If it says may, you may do it. Those words are chosen very, very specifically with very specific purpose. We had a contracting officer at DARPA that used to knock on the table and say, read the BAA. Read the BAA. Please read the BAA. It's a very, very important document. So with that, I'm going to stop. Thank you all for coming. Really excited about the day. And I'm going to hand it over to my colleague, Craig.
Hey, everybody. Craig Gravitz here. I'm the commercialization dude. And you might be thinking, why are we thinking about the end? Right now, I didn't even get my contract award yet. That is by design. So one of the things that's very different about about us at ARPA-H versus DARPA is DARPA has a built-in customer. And you heard Amy talk about that a little bit. From my perspective, I always like to think about this as Colonel So-and-so. Colonel So-and-so creates what I like to call the pull-through effect. So when you have like a multi-gajillion dollar program that's going to, you know, create a stealth bomber, it's pretty easy to sort of like create a technology that sort of goes there. Some of the complexity gets hidden. Since our customer is all Americans, that pull-through effect isn't necessarily there. So even though Colonel so-and-so might be an American who needs some of these advancements, ultimately, in his personal capacity, he doesn't create that. And so one of the things that we've done here at ARPA-H is we've created my office, the transition office, to help Ross and to help folks like you, once you get an award, survive in the wild. So again, at a certain point, even if you make it through the end, ultimately, your technology is going to have to stand on its own. And so we're going to do everything we can to create that pull-through effect. So this is helping with FDA, you know, potentially helping with like CMS reimbursement pathways, helping with customers. And I'll give some more specific details in a second. But the basic idea is that you have to, you know, you don't have that one center of gravity, which is the D in DARPA. And so what we're going to do is have lots of other little things where we kind of make it a little bit easier for things to transition. So while we're asking a lot of you, we're going to do our best to help you at the same time. Okay, so this is kind of my take of what the model looks like. So again, you know, some of you are familiar with the DARPA model. In my mind, at least from a commercialization and transition perspective, these are the major milestones. And I won't read all of the little different things, but the gist is each of those bullets are specific services that we provide to Ross and to you, at Ross's discretion, to help make everybody succeed. And I'll just call out a couple, and we actually have some very specific examples. So many of you might be more science people, but there are IP considerations. And so understanding, you know, what that landscape looks like so that we don't create a time bomb or we, create some amazing technology that at the end of the day, you know, can't survive because it won't attract funding. So we work to de-risk it and we'll work with you to kind of complement your skills from the sort of commercial and regulatory side. So that, okay. So, this is previous to coming here to ARPA-H, I ran a technical program not at DARPA but at DoD, and I used to go out to Silicon Valley a lot to meet with my performers. Same way that, you know, Ross is going to be meeting with you, and very often I would see this little diagram on people's door, especially my better performers, and at first I thought it was like a weird cult thing, whatever. And eventually one time I actually asked, you know, one of the people, I'm like, what actually is this? And, you know, they told me there's this, you know, design from IDEO, if you're familiar with it. And this is a framework that they use to help drive innovation. And one of the things that I think I've been particularly successful at is adapting this in the government context. So I'm visual. So if you're going to go back here, this is the pipeline. If you kind of turn it, this is kind of like the other side of it. It's like a straw. You're like looking in the middle of the straw. And so basically, my office, the transition office, we try to de-risk kind of thinking about each of these different vectors separately. So one, the technical feasibility. Ross pretty much has that covered. But we will help Ross by, you know, with getting FDA regulatory support. Again, some of the things I mentioned earlier. We're also going to help on the desirability side. So this is making sure that our customers will enthusiastically adopt the technologies. One of the things that I often saw in my programs is you could create these amazing technological innovations, and you might even be able to start to get funding, but at the end of the day, people are like, I don't want that. And it's really important to understand that early on. So these goes to issues of trust. You know, do I trust this technology? Can I access this technology? Is it affordable for me? So you have to really think about the people at every step. It's not just the technology. And then finally, viability. And we're going to have some specific additional speaker, special guest star on that. But this is basically, how do you understand the market dynamics of a particular technology? You know, making sure that it is appropriately de-risked for investors, making sure that, you know, the IP is up to snuff, et cetera. Okay, so I just want to give you one more quick example of how we are putting this DVF, so desirability, viability, feasibility framework into practice. So Congress gave us the opportunity to have three geographic locations. And as you might have picked up from Amy's talk, our work happens everywhere. So in some respects, it really would not make a lot of sense if we were to just have like an Avengers building with like, you know, Renee at the top and like Amy in there. Doesn't really matter because ultimately our program managers, like the work is gonna be happening with all of you. And so what we decided to do is, you know, look at this in a unique way and figure out how can we extract, you know, the most value from this setup. And what we decided to do was use this DVF framework to create a National Health Innovation Network, a hub and spoke model. So a hub is gonna be sort of the center of gravity for certain activities, and a spoke will be another location across the country that can kind of complement the hub. And the idea is that if our mission is to accelerate better health outcomes for all Americans, we need to actually be everywhere in America. And so we're building this right now. It's under active source selection, so I can't give you any details. But the feasibility will ultimately come out of our stakeholders and operations hub, which is in the National Capital Region right now. Again, technology, so this is where we have our FDA coordination, CMS coordination, and where you might find Ross kind of hanging out from time to time. We're gonna have a separate hub that's dedicated to customer experience. So this is how we're gonna really start to solve for people and make sure that, again, these technologies are trustworthy, adoptable, affordable. This is where you might do MVP testing, or where you might launch a novel clinical trial or a diverse clinical trial, whatever. It's going to map very much to the needs of the particular program. And then finally, there'll be an investor catalyst hub that is focused on those market dynamics and and making sure, again, that the performers can survive in the wild when funding ends. The way that'll work in practice, so it's not built yet, we're in the process of building it, is we'll launch specific projects in there, and you kind of see these placeholders, and those projects will probably take place in other cities, if that makes sense. So again, using the clinical trial example, if you launch a clinical trial through our customer experience hub, it might take place at a different geographic location than where the hub is. And so we're building that right now. That will be a tremendous resource to our performers and to Ross, because as his program is developing, he'll be able to tap this network to really support everything that he's doing. Okay, so I just want to focus just kind of zero in on one of the capabilities that we're launching as it relates to viability, and this is our Experts in Residence program. We recognize that our program managers, as amazingly smart as they are, don't really know everything. How can they? I mean, Ross might, but other program managers might not. And so we're bringing in folks who can complement their expertise, advise them as programs are maturing to make sure, again, he's doing a sort of overall landscaping, and then he can lean on some of these experts for specifics. And I'd like to introduce you to one of those wonderful experts right now. Misty, you wanna come describe a little bit what you do? All right.
Thanks. Me? Okay. So it's a pleasure to be here. As Craig mentioned, I'm Misty Ushio. I'm here representing Digitalis Commons, which is the not-for-profit affiliate of Digitalis Ventures. And so collectively, we build companies and invest in projects to really solve important problems in health. And so Digitalis Commons is partnered with ARPA-H, and we're really excited through their patio program to really support the program managers, performers, kind of like any kind of aspect that would be helpful to really, make sure that if the innovation works, that it can translate to patients and provide better outcomes. So as early stage company builders, and I'll give you a little background about myself, we've seen a lot of examples and companies and situations where even though the science works and even though technology works, it's just these forces that can't get to market. And it could be IP related, it could be market, it could be sales channels, it could be regulatory. And so what we're really here is to work with you from over the whole course of the project. So at the beginning, it might be more market landscape, technology landscape, IP strategy. It might move to regulatory, maybe manufacturing, pricing, market competition. And then maybe towards the tail end, like, is this something that could then get venture funded? Is this better to be in a home and a company and how to make sure all of those pieces are in place. Just quickly on me, I have a PhD in biochemical engineering. I spent about 10 years at Merck doing vaccine research, and then spent another 10 years doing early stage investing at a venture fund in New York. And through that, it wasn't really my plan, but ended up founding a company called Terra Biosystems in organ on a chip space, and built that, which was acquired about a year ago. And so, you know, we have a vast network. Like, we won't be able to solve everything, but our goal is to identify where we can help and get the right support at the right time. And I would be happy to talk to any of you today, and I'm really excited to be a part of this.
And just to wrap up a little bit, one of the other functions that my office has is to bring in partners. So you saw Amy gave a slide where there's kind of different like patient advocate groups, investors. So I do a lot of travel with Renee, and we go to different cities, meet with different types of people. What we try to do is get a 360 view, you know, performers, academics, business types, and really patient groups, and really just try to understand in the various spaces who are the people that we ought to be engaging in. And Misty's a really great example of the power of this function. So we did a trip up to New York, and Misty actually showed up on two different panels. So in the morning, in her role as a kind of like, hey, this is the company perspective, and in the later one, it was more from the investment side, like, this is a person that we need to work with. Just really double tapping on that concept that if ARPA-H is truly going to solve for all Americans, we need to be everywhere. And so I know all of you are from different places. You might be seeing us in your capacity, either as a performer under the NITRO program or just generally in our travels. So, you know, feel free to say hi as you're bumping around today. If you have reason for ARPA-H to come visit, let me know, and we might be able to facilitate that. So with that, I will hand it back to Ross. You're up next.
Okay, so this QR code will take you to our website in case you still haven't looked at that. That website will be updated over time, but let's discuss probably part of the reason why you're here, to find out more about the program. I think it's worth level setting. R&D can be myopic, and you can forget what the end goal is. So this is the end goal. It's what we're looking to do. It's a platform technology in regenerative medicine with a focus on OA. If you don't know it, OA is the number three leading cause of disability. We have 78.8 million US Americans currently affected by this, and I think it's roughly 240 people globally. That's in 2040. 32.5 currently, 240 globally, and projected to surge to about 2 billion. In a decade. And remember, this is a five-year program, so there's going to be a massive surge while the program's happening. It's expensive, not just for the direct medical costs of treating OA, but for the indirect medical costs of unemployment. There's an affiliated opiate cost that we're looking to tackle as well. You can see on the bottom right bullet point that the knee OA population alone generates $14 billion over the course of their lifetime. It affects roughly a quarter of the American population, and anyone over 45, there's an 88% chance you have it. Now, this is diagnosed. There are a lot of people who might be a KL grade one that we don't even know about. So there is this looming multi-headed hydra of problems that we're looking to address with all of this. Tied in with the notion that ARPA-H is looking to meet Americans everywhere, we have to also acknowledge that this is not a wealthy white person disease. In fact, it's quite the opposite. It's two times more common in females, most likely in multiracial, non-Hispanic, and Native American, Native Alaskan populations. So what you'll see, if you haven't already looked, is that the equity metrics tie in with that. As a performer in the program, any performers will be required to have equity officers, and we'll tap on that a bit. It's a really important part for us. It is a critical go-no-go determination. If you don't meet the clinical demographics of this population in the clinical trials, and I know historically clinical trials don't normally have these high standards, and that's exactly the point. So you're probably aware of the current standard of care, which is to say, as a surgeon who does these things, pretty abysmal. The standard of care is you show up, you're in pain, we try to treat your pain, you get some physiotherapy, we put some things in your joints, and almost invariably you need a total joint replacement. And then 15 years later, you need a total joint replacement. And then 20 years later, you might need a total joint replacement, and you might be out of runway. And if that starts at 40, you might be having a painful joint, and you just deal with it for the rest of your life until you might die of the heart disease that's concomitant with this disease, or the obesity, or the depression, or everything else that comes with this. So tackling one tackles many. MACI has its limitations. We have a lull between procedures. It's a two-stage procedure, so 6 to 8 weeks of waiting time. It's provider dependent, so I might be great with my hands with the membrane. Somebody else might say that they're great and it's terrible. There's still a risk of graft failure, arthrofibrosis, ankylosis, failure, total joint. So even though that is the standard of care, it should not be the standard of care. And again, we're looking to fix that and course correct it. The reason this is up there truly is because there are two populations we see in the program. There's the population, if we're going to use the KL grading scale, there's a population from 0 to 3 who have tissue that can be regenerated, we think. And that's the hope. Scientifically, there's tissue that can be regenerated and two different tissue types, subchondral bone, cartilage. Those people, the aim is to get them back to grade 0. And we'll talk about that in a moment. The real aim of the program is to take grade 4 back to 0. But there's always the possibility that somebody comes in with avulsive trauma, or they just need a total joint. They need a replacement of their existing joint, and we have to do some kind of total joint replacement. Now, we're going to start focusing on TKAs, but generally speaking, that population shouldn't be told, hey, in 15 years, we'll see you again. The goal of the program is, if you need a total joint, it is a one and done. No fixation, one joint, go live your life. And in fact, we're going to see a surge in TKAs alone to 3.5 million. The annual joint registry is off the charts in terms of what we're expecting over time. And it's still one of the most revised surgeries we do. Risk of hardware infection, 26%. Hardware failure, infection, both 26%. And still, that's not addressing the pain component that comes with this. There's an opportunity for different pain modalities. And I know that we've pushed away clinically from let's use opiates. But we also know, if anyone's a provider in the room, that if a patient is pushing for opiates and it's against our best judgment, sometimes you still give them the opiates. And that's not where we're trying to head with the program. So the vision for the future is broad and vast and is just the beginning of what we hope for regenerative medicine. We want to revolutionize the care algorithm. We want to prevent pain. We want to decrease the economic burden and eliminate the need for repeat joint surgery. So a lot going on in the slide, but generally speaking, this is a full revolutionary platform. So we've talked about platform technologies and disease specific, and this is both. We're going to tackle a disease, but in the course of tackling a disease and figuring out how to regenerate tissues in a minimally invasive fashion, we hopefully unlock the keys for, or the doors for, all other tissues that we can find. But let's start with a major disease. So eradicating the disease is the goal here. There has been a lot of talk in the industry of let's halt the progression of the disease. Just to foot stomp this, that's not what we're doing. I think it's great that we found out some ways potentially to stop the progression. We're looking to regenerate in reverse, and that's what we're looking for. If the replacement is needed, we mentioned no revisions necessary. This will be deliberate, efficient, and effective forward progress through a variety of methods you've heard about already and we're going to be talking about. So we have clinical trial stakeholders. We'll talk about the equity officers in a moment. We're going to talk about the model symposium. Hopefully you saw the brief shout out in the BAA, but the model symposium is going to be a critical part of us getting this faster. Talk about that in a moment. The FDA, we've met with them already. There are going to be regular touch points with them, both on my side and on your side, as well as FDA consultants in the performer population. Patio has it more than covered in terms of how we get these to market, because it's great if we make cool tech that gets published in Science or Nature, and it's not so great for us. It's not so great for you as patients, because it doesn't really mean anything. So here, successful exit from ARPA is successful exit to the patient population. And tying in with that is the public market buy-in. The big thing, again, hammering home equitable access. So if it's $10,000 and that's the great first foray into the space, that's not great for us. We want to make sure that this can meet the older lady in Detroit as much as it can meet the wealthy person in LA and everywhere in between. So we've talked about a little bit with this model. I came in with some ideas, defended them. Those are the programs. This became the program that I focused on. We had launched Nitro. We released the BAA. You're aware of that. If you're not aware of it, go read it. Then we have Proposers Day. So this is an opportunity, again, to find out about what's in the BAA on a cursory level and to talk to each other, figure out how you can maybe join together to figure out the TAs. And then the program is launched. Once we have our proposals in, we've done our scientific review, and we have our teams off to the races. And Dr. Jenkins mentioned this, but just because you're a performer at the beginning does not mean you're a performer at the end. There are non-negotiable metrics. So even though somebody might say, I have the solution for TA1 except for this thing, then you don't have the solution for TA1. Same with TA2, same with TA3. So to find the solutions here is to operate within the structure and check every metric at every gated time point. And finally, we transition to practice. And we have our three TAs. So TA1 is a needle-based and or non-invasive subchondral bone regenerative. The focus here is that it's intra-articular. We'll talk about all the specific nitty-gritty there, but this is the bone TA. TA2, needle-based and or non-invasive cartilage regenerative. This is IA and IV, two different things that have to be created here. TA3 is an allogeneic and, not or, autogenous, non-immunogenic, load-bearing, and osteochondroinductive total joint replacement with no permanent fixation. There are obviously a lot of approaches. The big goal of what we launch here is that it's non-prescriptive. So I don't look at the landscape and go, all right, well, company X has solved it, so we're just going to write a BAA for company X. In fact, it's quite the opposite. I've probably interacted with a majority of the people here and online, or in some capacity looked at the papers. Our team has looked at it. We just determined that there are a lot of different approaches. You can see these on the slides, and that's not all inclusive. What I mean by that, and what Dr. Jenkins again mentioned, is if it's something that could pass regulatory muster, it can be in a range of different things. It just has to hit the metrics. So if you're a genetic engineer and you're like, well, I don't do chondrospheres, that's okay. Just hit the metrics. There are three formulations here. So you can pick your flavor, like kind of like a Denny's menu. You can do TA 1 and 2, so there is no opportunity to split these out. You do both or none. And again, with the teaming component here, somebody might be very good at TA 1. Somebody might be very good at TA 2. It is up to the lightning talks today and your networking to figure out how to combine to make that happen. It is not up to us to facilitate that for you. Other option is TA 3. Let's say you just want to do implantables. Just that implant, that is all. Not to say that's a diminished, easier one. Far from it, but that's another option if you just want to do that approach, or you take the full Monty approach and say, we're going to tackle the entire program. Up to you. The timeline is as such. So therapeutic discovery, we're allowing 24 months. And the real key here is sometimes tied into the fact that, and we'll do the nitty-gritty here. Again, some people say, I've solved it, but for these things. In order to solve it, you have to hit all those things. We're giving you the time to do that and try it out in your animal model if you choose to use an animal model. You don't have to. We'll talk about the animal model in a second. Then you get to preclinical. That is our large animal model. According to the FDA, if you find one idealized animal model, which will tie directly into our symposium, then you can do this once correctly, direct concordance with human physiology, and get approval. So we're looking to streamline that process, and again, with the FDA buy-in that we're going to talk about. And finally, phase one clinical trials. 18 months, all of this is aggressive. There's a reason why, and that's why it's ARPA, that's why it's ARPA hard. We constantly use the ARPA hard phrasing. If it'd be another agency, you'd see different timelines. And we're looking to revolutionize the standard of care. So everything on the white border is where we are now. Everything in blue is where we're looking to go. So we need to address disease heterogeneity. Some people, let's say, might have OA in their phalanges. Rather than saying to your 85-year-old grandma, I want to inject into each one of her fingers, there's an IV approach. If somebody has knee OA and it's just one knee and at the doctor's discretion, they need only their cartilage and their knee regenerated, that's up to them to say, I'm just going to use the TA2 approach here in their knee. So there's a lot of wiggle room in terms of how we're looking to tackle this. We're not going to make it two-stage, so surgical procedures decreased 50%, zero permanent fixation, so 100% to 0% on the chart. The replacement necessity, the reason there's a little bit of wiggle room there is because if somebody has an existing titanium alloy joint, this gives them the opportunity to have a nitro joint. Pain, big thing here. So opiate tie-in, we want it less than 3 out of 10. So a 70% reduction in current pain standards. We're looking for less than 3 out of 10. You're going to see it all over the BAA. From the gate, so at the beginning, Craig's team is going to be talking with us and with performers in the program about commercialization. To talk about commercialization at phase 2.2 is a failure of the program and a failure of my leadership of the program if that's the case. So we are going to have regular touch points constantly about how we get something that looks good in phase 1 to way beyond phase 2 into the patient sector. So let's get the metrics. Again, all of this is in the BAA. This is just to reiterate what we're looking for. To get to phase 2, you have to pass phase 1. There's not the immediate, like, well, I'm good enough there. I can start start at the beginning with everyone else. So for TA1, again, the bone, we're looking for greater than or equal to one therapeutic, no harvest. It has to regenerate defects at and beyond critical size defects, so things that the body wouldn't do on its own, and generate autogenous signals to do that. So regenerative medicine only. We're looking for regeneration here from all grading. So end grade back to native in all synovial joints. It must be needle-based, including arthroscopic and or non-invasive. So this hopefully gives a bit more opportunity for people to say, well, you know, maybe I want to use an arthroscopic approach, or maybe I want to use a microneedle patch, or maybe I just want to use a standard 18-gauge needle or 16-gauge, whatever. It is open to your interpretation on this one as long as it falls within that bandwidth. And then the big one, this has to ideally be less than or equal to one dose per year in tandem with TA2. So the vision here is, let's say, I use the example of somebody with a knee injury. So your 25-year-old soccer star who just blew their right knee out. That person might not have bone on bone. That person might only have cartilage degeneration. So we only use TA2. It's somebody essentially puts a lower lock needle in there or whatever your introductory system is. Regenerate using TA2 methodology, get out of Dodge. It's at the doctor's discretion. So if they have somebody who comes in like David Goggins, both knees bone on bone, that's a different story. In a population where there's joint space and you can regenerate it and it doesn't require a total joint, you have the opportunity to use TA1 and 2 essentially as, I'm gonna use the example of a needle. This is not the only answer here, just to be clear. Needle in, lure lock, TA1 goes in, TA2 goes in, we pull out. And that is the only solution for the year. That's all that person needs for that year. Then there's a population where the David Goggins comes in and it's bone on bone and there's no joint space. Well, you can regenerate bone and cartilage all day, but there's nowhere for it to go because it's already a degraded joint. That population benefits from TA3. So I'm hoping you can start to see where the vision is for the program, that it's not to say we're gonna take a joint that is clearly requiring an open joint surgery and say, we'll regenerate everything inside when there's clearly no space. It gives the opportunity to do a total joint still. So once you've passed the TA or the phase one metrics here, you have 24 months for that. We have regular touch points, monthly meetings. You will get tired of hearing from me. You will get tired of hearing from my CETAs, and that's the point, because if you want the money, you have to be in the game. So phase two then begins with preclinical trials. Using the appropriate OA large animal model, we will touch on this in a moment when we talk about the symposium, your new therapeutic has to sustain physiologically relevant load according to the ISO protocols, has to produce full function. So the MACI standard of care is full function at 6 months. And what I mean by full function is not weight bearing is tolerated in slow walking. It is you're back to your normal life. You never had a procedure. Less than or equal to 3 months post-op with greater than 85% success. That is far superseding this current standard of care. And finally, pain less than 3 out of 10. And then at the very end, you're getting into phase 1 clinical trials. We're talking about how to transition you out of the program, assuming that clinical trials go well. TA2, similar story. The only real differentiator here is that you're producing two therapeutics. One IA, so the same as TA1, but also an IV approach. I'll leave that up to you. Otherwise, all the same things. And finally, TA3, so this is our implantable. Load-bearing TKA, so we're only gonna do a TKA for the program, allograft and autograft. So you must produce two, and I'll explain why. They have to be patient-specific. There must be no permanent fixation. So even if it's a day after, no permanent fixation. If it's 6 months after, no permanent fixation. Not like I'm gonna put plates and screws in and then ask surgeons to take them out in 3 months. Not the story. They have to be osteochondroinductive. So the vision here is, the surgeon at Walter Reed, I have people who come in with a bulge of trauma. They're not gonna wait for 4, 6, 8, 12 weeks to get a total joint. They need it right now. So right now, the standard of care is a stock joint. They have three sizes, you put it in, best of luck, we'll see you sooner than 10 years. That population, we hope to get them a joint that is patient-specific and is essentially a ghost construct within 24 hours. So they come in, they're still an inpatient, they have their surgery, they discharge with a joint. It is not as idealized as an autograft, but it is far more idealized than the current standard of care. And at least the goal is we're still giving them a joint and they walk off into the sunset. But it's far better than what we have. If they can afford to wait, so they're the grandmother who has no comorbidities and her hip's just kind of bothering her, and we know she's treatment planned for an autograft, or I'm sorry, for a total joint, she can wait for 30 days and it just becomes patient specific. But we're capping it at 30 days so that she, whomever, has an autograft that is completely patient specific. The other thing you'll notice, so a full function less than or equal to 4 to 6 weeks post-op. That is also an aggressive timeline, and intentionally so. We want people back on their feet faster than the standard of care of saying you have to be mobile, but you have to be mobile very slowly, weight bearing is tolerated, 6 weeks. That will also change as a result of the program. Must sustain load, implant must be stable greater than 12 months, and then you're in phase 1 clinical trials. Across all of these, we also have metrics that have to cover what's happening in the background. At the beginning of the program, you're beginning your IND application. You're identifying manufacturing partners in collaboration with our hub and spoke network. You're talking to our patio team, to me, to all of the resources that we have as an agency to figure out how do we get these things into a manufacturing capability perspective and a scalability perspective fast. Everything here is going to seem very fast, and that is just like the program was the fastest launch in history. This will be a fast program, just like all the other programs. By Q4 of 24, you've submitted for the Interact meeting package, and that is an FDA pipeline program that allows you to have touch points independently as a proposer with them to figure out what they're looking for. Obviously, they're not going to spoon feed you, but it is a pipeline that they're encouraging, and they've encouraged me to start advertising for them. That's the OTAT Interact meeting. By Q3 of FY25, you've submitted your pre-IND meeting package again to discuss with them, hey, here's our data, here's where we're looking to go. That's across all TAs. You'll also be working with the patio team with XIRs, EIRs, hub and spoke model, all of the complement parts and pieces to start talking about commercialization. And commercialization doesn't just mean how do we get this paid for. It also means the IP landscape that Craig discussed. Phase 2.1, preclinical, you're now doing GLP manufacturing and producing GCP and cGMP material for 20 to 100 patients for any of the TAs. And you've completed, by the end of this 2.1 phase, your IND enabling studies and application. You're then using the patio assets in a more tangible way now that you have all of this data and you know where we're going or you're not going, and you have our go, no-go requirements to say, hey, here's what we really need to do to get to clinic because you have 18 months left until the end of the program if you succeed. And finally, the phase 1 clinical trials, this has to be scalable for 1,000 plus patients in a cGMP compliant fashion, and we are transitioning you out. So a successful exit doesn't mean we hold your hand in the government forever and you have a government contract, it means you're out in the market. Big focus of ARPA and the big focus of mine and a passion point for our entire team is making sure this is equitable. And we have had a litany of meetings to make sure that we have the groundwork to build this out for you and with you. And we've talked to quite literally every office in the agency. There will be one integrated equity officer who you will pick and we will approve for you as a performer, who will be responsible for guiding each of your teams towards meeting the equity metrics of the BAA. This does encompass everything. Please look at the BAA, but the real touch points here are your equity officer is going to define your equity KPIs, have listening sessions with people in the community who are affected. So we talked about greater than 50% female, Native Americans, Native Alaskans, multi-race non-Hispanic. All of those people have to be integrated into listening sessions. And again, it's all listed out in the BAA. They're going to create a roadmap to equity, and we're going to be working, and we've already started this process, the insurance action plan. So we've met with CMS, we've met with CMMI, we're talking to IHS, we're trying to figure out what the process is to have some ICD-10 cross-cover, CPT code cross-cover, and make sure that this is something where, again, we have targeted metrics to say, hey, at the end of this program in 5 years, here's what we've accomplished from an equity standpoint. This is X percent of the current standard of care. This is covered by every insurance provider. And then they're gonna partner with the Animal Care Act stakeholders as well. Phase two, very much the meat and potatoes of the equity team as well, is these go, no-go requirements. This is a reflection of the accurate population distribution of the disease, which is why it's going to be the metric for the program. Greater than 50% females for the clinical trials, this is the enrollment requirement, and plus minus 5% so that it must reflect roughly 21% multi-race non-Hispanic, roughly 20% Native American, Native Alaskan, 18% non-Hispanic white, so on and so forth. You can see it on the slide. So this is a critical part of the program, and I hope that it makes it very clear about what we're looking to do here. Okay, so it has dawned upon us, and it dawned upon us pretty quickly, that everyone has what they consider to be the best animal model, and that also suggests that there is a best animal model. There is something that is maybe cost-effective for your lab, there is something that is maybe cost-effective for you, or something that works well in your hands, kind of like a surgeon in a membrane. So the goal here is to standardize everything for the entire industry. This is open, importantly, to the entire marketplace, so not just performers, proposers in the program, because I think that could be myopic. So It'll be open to everyone, but strongly encouraged for any potential performers. This will be open to industry, academia. We'll have members of the FDA present, veterinarians, CROs, manufacturers, the list goes on and on and on. Anyone who thinks they're a stakeholder who wants to have their voice heard in terms of how animal models should be used, what the best one is, what reflects physiology, will be there. The first meeting, and we'll release a special notice very shortly, will take place on September 6th in Washington, D.C. The goal right now is to do a biannual meeting series, and you'll be done with the symposium before the end of phase one. And the goal being there is, let's say you get to the end of phase one and somebody has determined it's animal model X. It has to be justified, and you have to have time to integrate that into your phase two plans because you're going to be using it from the bottom up, phase 2.1. We already touched on this a bit, but having the FDA say, if we pick one idealized model, we can streamline this, to us is a sign that that's the direction we should be heading. Let's pick one, let's move with that, and everyone has concordance. In keeping with that, anyone who's attending the symposium, but particularly the performers, are asked to publish together and have this consensus model. So say and commit to it publicly, we're using this, we believe in this, and that will be what you'll be using, unless it is something that's obscene, and we'll have to mitigate that risk at that time. The ideal here is not that it only mitigates risk for the performers, but anyone who's doing OA research moving forward and kind of sets a standard for regenerative medicine, carte blanche, if you want to do this, find an animal model. And we've talked about commercialization. I don't think I need to hammer this home any further than it has been. So in the military, we say bluff, big line up front. These are your dates. We are welcoming abstracts, but they're due next Friday. And there's six pages. We strongly encourage proposals. Those are due July 28th. Those are 40 pages. So please take it seriously. Please follow the metrics. You're going to hear all about how this is constructed, but I want to make it clear the abstracts, if you choose to submit them next Friday, 5 p.m., full proposals due July 28th, OA Symposium, September 6th. Again, welcoming abstracts, strongly encourage proposals. And with that, I believe it's time to turn it over to our acquisition team to find out about funding mechanisms. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Tracy Newsom. I work in the Business Innovation Division. Specifically, I work as a contracting officer in the R&D branch led by Ryan Daniels. So I have about eight slides to talk about some items with the BAA and the application process. First, I think the most fundamental and basic question, what is a BAA and why did we select this, the nomenclature and the method for the to support the NITRO program? So BAAs are a widely used and thus highly recognized process to, that feedback, how do I, it just won't go.
Like a half step.
Okay.
You did really well, better than me. I was thrown off.
A process to procure R&D. The process is established in FAR Part 35, and it's used by both DoD and non-DoD agencies. The process allows for award of different or multiple award types, and despite the fact that there is no common statement of work, it's considered a competitive process. So we anticipate that each award will have a unique statement of work. All of that, I hope, aligns with what you've already read in the BAA. Those are characteristics of what we think we need to support the NITRO program. Typically, because the BAA process is established in FAR Part 35, agencies who are using it are going to negotiate FAR contracts as well. And as you also know from reading our BAA, we are not doing that. What that means is that not only does the FAR not apply to the award instruments we will be doing, which are cooperative agreements and other transaction agreements, but the FAR does not apply to the entire process. So the solicitation, the evaluation and selection, and then the administration of those. So the question is, why would we use that nomenclature and award type, process to support the NITRO BAA? And the answer is we considered a few factors given the timeline we had to support the NITRO program. First, the FAR BAA process is outlined there. It complies on a high level with the statutory requirements for providing financial assistance in HHS. So for instance, that's 45 CFR Part 75. Second, because it is so widely used, there's the brand recognition factor. So we anticipate that all of you in the community who are, you know, potential performers and potential proposers are familiar. You have existing experience and understanding with the process. And finally, with the FAR process, it was developed with an emphasis on equity, transparency, and ultimately integrity. So those values, along with the element of the competitive process, we see as very important. They should always be integral in any funding opportunity notice or solicitation and award process. So that's why we've elected to use the nomenclature and the FAR process to, we've modeled that in our BAA, even though the FAR itself will not apply to the process. So hopefully that adds some clarity of why we use that. Some specifics about the NITRO BAA itself. As I mentioned, we will not be negotiating FAR procurement contracts. We will be providing financial assistance through cooperative agreements and then negotiating other transactions agreements. We will select the award type based on a number of factors. We will consider what you as the proposers request, and then we will look at the specific factors of the project to ultimately determine what makes the most sense. For the, unlike the open BAA, which is, I'm sure you've seen, is running for a full year, it's open and proposals can come in. Ours, as Amy and Ross said, it will close on July 28th when full proposals are due. We estimate the evaluation timeline, we're going to be as efficient as possible. We estimate evaluations will be complete within 45 days so that people will be hearing back by the 11th of September. Similar to the open BAA though, there are no funding caps on individual projects and there's no funding cap associated or ceiling associated with the NITRO program as a whole. To get into a little bit about the two different award types that we'll award, and I know Amy touched on this a bunch in the sense that in terms of financial assistance, we will be providing cooperative agreements and not grants. Cooperative agreements are distinguished, and as Amy mentioned, from grants because of the substantial involvement by the government. And substantial involvement is the statutory term. So it can cover a wide variety of activities. In the BAA right now, we specify some of those reporting and more oversight type things that Amy referenced, and those are beyond what you would expect in a grant. In addition to that, and what we think is most beneficial, although we value that the metrics and the oversight that will help ensure accountability, we think the most goodness is going to come from our technical assistance and the collaboration that can occur early and consistent throughout the entire process. And that collaboration, we expect, will increase the innovation and improve the ultimate project results in support of the NITRO program. Similar to thinking cooperative agreements are more aligned with our program needs as opposed to grants, we think that other transactions agreements are more aligned and are going to help us support the program as opposed to FAR procurement contracts. As you can see on the slide, other transactions agreements or OTs are contracts. You know, there's an offer, acceptance, consideration. So they are legally contracts, they're just not FAR procurement contracts. And that is a very important distinction. And we anticipate that you and the community will be very welcome to that distinction because when we are not bound by the FAR, we're able to leverage commercial practices and we can negotiate not all of the terms and conditions, but most of them. For instance, one of the ones that always comes up is intellectual property. And in FAR procurement contracts, we are very limited in what we can do with that. But within OTs, we have much more flexibility to design it in a way mutually beneficial and ultimately most advantageous to the government. So again, cooperative agreements compared to grants, there's that collaboration. And the same with the other OTs. They allow for early and continuing ongoing collaboration that we think is greater than what would be allowed if we're constrained by the FAR. So we think it will help us improve the project results, ultimately increase innovation, and ultimately just select or support the NITRO program better than a FAR contract could. So on this slide, what I wanted to emphasize, and Ross just touched on this, but because the amendment was just released yesterday, hopefully you all saw that in SAM, the dates show 13 June, but the effective date in SAM is the 14th. But in the amendment that was just posted, we updated the BAA to show that abstracts are optional. They are welcome, but not required. Further, if you're going to submit them, they will be evaluated solely against criterion 1, not 2 and 4. One thing that did not change, if you are going to submit them, you need to submit them in ECPS. And there's instructions in the BAA that are hopefully very clear. So now we'll be receiving full proposals in potentially three different paths. One, you've submitted your abstract and you've received feedback limited to that we encourage you to submit a full proposal. So you submit a full proposal. You may also receive feedback that we have discouraged you to submit a full proposal, but we are not prohibiting that. So you ultimately could still submit a proposal. And finally, now that the abstract's optional, you might not have submitted one and are just submitting the full proposal. I want to emphasize, and it is clear in the BAA, but while the ECPS is used for all abstracts, whether you're requesting an other transaction or a cooperative agreement, when you're submitting your full proposals, if you are requesting a cooperative agreement, you will need to upload your application in grants.gov. And we have finally worked out our new agency system and account kinks. So hopefully in the very near future, you will see this funding opportunity notice, the BAA posting within grants.gov, and then you'll see where you can upload your package. If you are requesting another transaction, you will submit your full proposal in ECPS, the same as you did for your abstract. Let's see. And then in the evaluation, the only thing I would emphasize again is that now with the abstract, we are only evaluating against criterion 1, not 2 and 4. But for the full proposal, that did not change, and we will be evaluating against 4 criteria. They're listed in the BAA, and here, these are the 3 non-price, non-cost ones. They're listed in descending order of importance, which hopefully conveys to you how we see them relatively in terms of what is important. And so the first one, again, is the only one for the abstract, and all of the rest are going to be evaluated for the full proposal. The fourth criterion, the price and cost one, I will go into a little more detail here because this is the third area of a substantive change in the amendment posted yesterday on the 14th. We corrected what was somewhat of a discrepancy in that anyone requesting a cooperative agreement will need to complete the SF-424A, which is the budget spreadsheet form for ARPA-H. So if you're requesting an other transaction, you will complete the ARPA-H standard cost proposal spreadsheet, and that did not change. But previously, we had indicated only universities would use the secondary spreadsheet, but we've clarified that it is anyone requesting a cooperative agreement will fill out that form. It is a Excel spreadsheet that incorporates all the elements of the SF-424 R&R budget form with the ARPA-H cost proposal spreadsheet. We did not post or upload the spreadsheets in the last amendment. We had been anticipating responding with them in emails, but now that the abstracts are optional, an amendment will be coming in the near future to include those uploads. When we're evaluating those, which we'll do for every full proposal, we will evaluate price reasonableness, which is basically, is your price too high? And that will be done for all full proposals. We're not required to, but we may also complete a cost realism analysis. And what this means is basically, is your price or estimated cost too low? So we'll look at the statement of work that you proposed, along with the method, your technical approach to complete that statement of work. So the means, methods, all the details that you tell us how you're going to do that statement of work. And we are going to say, this is the likely cost, what we think is the probable or likely cost of your approach to accomplish your statement of work. And then we'll look at your cost and we'll say, do they match up? Is it realistic? Is it too low? And then finally, we'll look at the affordability of it. Do we have enough funds to fund your cooperative agreement or OT. My last slide, just as some final reminders or tips, please continue to monitor SAM.gov. If you did not see the amendment, please make sure you go look right away to look at the amendment. And as I noted, we will be posting another amendment with, at a minimum, it will include those 2 spreadsheets. Hopefully it will also, if we receive Q&A, I see people writing questions, so I assume we're going to receive some. We will also be posting answers to those questions, which there were also Q&A in the amendment posted yesterday. It was associated with that amendment. So that amendment should come out no later than the week of June 26. It'll have the two spreadsheets, any Q&A we receive, and then if the Q&A causes us to revise anything. We will also, as I said, be posting in grants.gov as soon as possible. So you should be seeing that, which I know is relevant only for those requesting cooperative agreements. The third bullet is more just a reminder, which maybe I should pound the table or pound the podium. Please read the BAA. This lists examples of the eligibility and the special requirements for cooperative agreements, but the BAA is very clear with format requirements, you know, page counts, margins, fonts, anything. So please read it and follow it. And then finally, just to emphasize, the BAA is the binding document. So anything you've seen on the slides here, anything you hear us say as we're presenting in sidebars, lightning talks, or side conversations, if you think anything conflicts with the BAA or adds ambiguity, please send us an email at nitro@arpah.gov. We will consider it, and if necessary, we'll revise or amend the BAA. But unless or until you see a written change posted publicly in SAM.gov and grants.gov, please consider what's posted to be what is binding. And now I will turn it over to my illustrious colleague, Josh.
Hello, my name is Josh Brown. I'm the business financial manager for the NITRO program. So as part of your proposal, you'll have to complete the ARPA-H cost proposal spreadsheet. This will assist us in reviewing your proposals quickly and evaluating the proposed costs. And if you're selected, it will greatly speed up the negotiation and award process. Please make sure that all of your proposed costs have the basis and rationale in there. And the spreadsheet, the first three tabs of the spreadsheet are directions for how to complete the rest of the spreadsheet. Please read carefully and follow the instructions, and then go on to phase one and two tabs to complete those, and everything will automatically total in the total amount tab. You will be able to add other costs, travel, subproposer costs, materials in separate tabs. Just please make sure that everything tracks back to the total amount tab. And please don't change anything in the spreadsheet. If there's something you don't need in there, just hide it or ignore it. And that's all I have, Ross. Thank you.
For anyone who's virtual, there is an opportunity. I believe we've already closed registration on this, but for sidebars next week as well. Generally speaking, I just wanted to touch on the abstract feedback and what is being evaluated next week, because that's the first time point. So again, the 23rd, 5 p.m. is the deadline for abstracts. They are welcome, not required. You're going to get one of two stock letters back, though. So do not expect feedback on your science is good for this reason or bad for this reason. It's not going to be that. You're going to get a letter that says we encourage or discourage, and that is it. So the opportunity for feedback is pretty much just that. Now, we'll be looking at the scientific merits on our end, but that's all that will be reflected to you, and you can choose to do with that what you will. So if you get a discouraging letter, that doesn't mean you can't submit a proposal. It's just that is our perspective based on what we're looking at from scientific merit. So hopefully that level sets what you're going to expect downrange from the abstract submission. And then again, proposals, 40 pages, July 28th, 5 p.m., and then the 45-day time window to give you feedback on that. The big thing, we've had a lot of great questions over the course of the day, online, in person, here with cards. Please feel free to reach out to the NITRO BAA email address with any further questions. We're going to be talking about everything internally and posting them online, just because if somebody asked a great question in a sidebar, it should be for everyone. So we'll be doing that consistently over the next week or two and moving forward as well to answer anything you might have. Please keep an eye on the website. Please keep an eye on SAM.gov as well, since we'll be updating the Q&A there. And it's going to be an exciting time. So we're looking forward to seeing what you guys put together. Thank you very much for coming.